Tuck it down?
Yeah, something like this.
Well, and he will speak about the Langlands quotient for symmetric spaces.
Alright, so thanks for inviting me to give a talk here for 2 years in a row. And I'm going to talk about the so let me talk about the Langlands quotient theorem. Well, what is it? Before talking about that, let me talk about the usual Langlands quotient theorem. So here's the setup. F is a monomorphic. Just for this talk, let's assume that the characteristic is 0. And then G is a reductive group. Defined over F. And then as usual, pi in the space of D is D. Here it is for that is all. Representation. G. And then just for convenience, let's assume that the central character is Euclid. And then we have the canonical pairing. Check the contour gradient. See. And then for each B in B and B check in B check, we define a map G to C by E check for A. And then here's the definition. The representation is called the temporal. Z is the center that we draw. Z is the center we draw. This is the epsilon. And B. Alright, and then now the Langlands quotient theorem What do you do food? Actually, I don't really know. Maybe long grass.
Oh,
actually, Archimedean is long grass bit. The other day, I tried to read his paper. I didn't understand anything. As usual. But for PR case, as far as I know, but actually, much later, it was pointed out by Kondo that there are some issues to be taken care of in the previous course. And they also, Van Johnson did it for the covering group. And as far as checked, as far as the proof is concerned, the proof given by Van Johnson is the easiest one to understand. Anyhow, whatever. So the theorem says this. Irreducible disorder representation. There exists a parabolic. Such that pi is unique of this in this representation. We unique after the choice of a positive symbol. Okay. And of course, pi is already tempered when the p is equal to g. Okay. And to be more precise, let me just explain what this stuff is. Maybe it's not the set of simple roots, just a fixed choice of set of simple roots, to be precise. But yes, set of simple roots. And for each roots defined by F, right? Each subset, we have the corresponding. Thank you. possible. The maximum torus, it's a maximum torus, that's the component and is the inner section of the torus. And then MI is the central axial. So this is, so to speak, an F split. Is the home. Rational cap, the space rational calculus. And then we just simply write. ASR. Empty. When A. I is empty, which is right down base R. Okay, so then we have base R. In general, for any I, this is a subset, subspace of this. Okay, then I'll fix. Pairing on A star to R, which is a wild group invariant. Okay, and then we define. Which is not in I. Okay, then now for each new, we define. Yeah. question.
MI.
What's that?
MI.
MI. Okay. Question mark and Q is of course Q and F is. But in more concrete language, if your G is a GLN and M is GLN 1, GLN, okay, then exponent mu of M1. That's some power on. Like this. And then this is in the positive cone plus if I'm leave. It's my other thing. So this is also the Langrand distribution. So that's the essential Langrand quotient theorem. Now, then the proof of Langrand quotient theorem. I'm not going to give the proof, of course, but essentially the key ingredient is what's called the Castleman's criterion for the hardness. This is by if I have time, I get back to this. Excuse me, Castleman's criteria. Then about this. So that's the key ingredient. Okay. Now, so that's the usual Langrand quotient theorem.
Which is of later origin. Castleman's criteria is of later origin.
Well, Castleman's criteria is what?
Langrand's quotient theorem was perhaps proved about 1970.
Uh-huh.
And Castleman's criteria maybe is 75.
Okay, maybe. Well, Langrand's proved it for Archimedean case. And for Archimedean case, we don't have this.
Sorry?
For Archimedean case, I don't know, but they are okay. But the modern proof.
Langrand's paper is about 1970.
Right, but that's for Archimedean case.
Yeah, but it's the same criteria and
right.
Same theorem.
Right, but they don't call it the Castleman's criteria.
Yeah.
Right. Anyway, I'm a historian, so. But nowadays, seems like everybody uses Castleman's criterion.
Yeah, meaning I have a feeling that this criteria is part of Harishchandra.
Also, this is not Castleman's criterion. It's like Harishchandra's criterion.
Yeah.
Okay. So some kind of criterion for temperatures. Okay. So that's not the usual Langrand's quotient theorem. Then now I'm going to actually relativize it to symmetric space in the following way. But before that, I have to set up some notation. So let's assume that we have an irrational involution sigma on so it's an involution, so sigma squared is equal to identity. Then now define H to be the simple element fixed by involution point, right? So this is G sigma. And then the space is called asymmetric space. So for example, if G is like G like E, where E is a plural extension, Galois group gives us sigma. In that case, H is G like F. But I would say the most important example is, so to speak, the group case. What is this? This is this. So G is simply a product of two groups G1 for some G1. And then sigma involution is given by G prime. This is we just switch to factors. And then what's H? Well, H is of course G. So this is the diagonal subgroup. This is the diagonal G1 inside G1. And if you look at this space, this is actually the same as G1. It goes G1 goes to G1. Diagonal G1. We have the OS mark. Okay, this is a group homomorphism. This is not really a group. That's a space. This. Okay, then now, here's the definition. Our representation of G is called H distinguished if there is a non-zero lambda in H star. Actually, title. Ancient variant linear form. Okay, and so if you apply this for the group case, so that means G is equal to G1 plus G1. So in this case, pi is always written as pi1 tensor pi1 prime. Right, and then pi is H distinguished. If and only if, but 1 is the contour gradient of the alpha. The height. Simple pi is given as pi 1. Yes, so pi 1, check. And in this case, actually, dimension of this space. So, and here, this space is actually spanned by the canonical theorem. Then now, there's another definition. Let's assume H is distinguished and for H distinguished with respect to this is from G mod H. C. Pi. This. E lambda B G is equal to lambda pi G inverse B. And then, indeed, it's defined over this portion. And then this is called. It's called. H lambda matrix coefficient. And then if you go back to the group case, so group case, the symmetric space is the same as G1, G is G1, okay, and then with this identification, this is the usual. So this one is, as I said, lambda is just a canonical pairing, and the V is always written as like V tensor V prime, or some of V tensor V, or V check. And then this is actually the usual. Whenever I realize that you guys get water. So now H distinct representation is called L distinct representation, H distinct is with respect to lambda is called H lambda temporal. If with this, basically just like the temporalness, the usual matrix function, we just consider this integral 2 plus so on. And then this is G over G order H, and then on this side you can go that by yourself, and this is equal to 0. And for all. And it is called H temporal. If it is H lambda temporal. Okay. And then, once again, if you do it in group case, if you look at the group case, pi is pi 1. H temporal if and only if pi 1 is temporal in units. Okay, then now let me just say that the theorem. But it's like a theorem because I'm not going to give a precise statement yet. So the theorem is basically we have the analog of the Langlands portion. In this, in the context of symmetric spaces, assuming our residue characteristic, is different. But to be more precise, in order to say the theory in a more precise way, let me give you more definitions. Our parabolic. If you look at the intersection you just get left. So it's basically the opposite parabolic. So group case once again G is G1 cross G1 and then sigma split parabolic is of the form some parabolic for G1 cross the opposite parabolic. Okay, and then now another definition. X both things. As things. If sigma S is S inverse for all S S, therefore a sigma split P we call SP sigma split component of so the group case. Then now if we have phi x star is a set of roots for this pair, we define phi bar to be the restriction. But each root alpha is essentially a character on AP, and SP is a subgroup A. And then we just exclude those guys. And then the proportion is the proportion is the old result by a couple of people, Helming and Wang. Is that this one is indeed this one inside this? Yes, it's a root system. But not necessarily, reduced.
So there are two Helmings.
Yeah, right.
Rather, so this is Aloysius.
Actually, that's the question I was afraid of. I don't know.
No, it's not the question. It's just a statement.
Okay, all right.
Aloysius Helm.
Okay. I can't tell one from the other.
CK, no? CK Helming.
No, A.
Helminck.
Yes. Ck.
Yeah. All right. Okay. And then a root system, and then okay. Then finally, so let's define this one class, just a positive form. So this is false, so speak positive form. So that's also defined. Because essentially this is just a set of functions on AP. And then this is a set of functions on SP. SP is a subfield of AP. This unit. Then I map like this. Then now, here's a theorem. Finally, I can say Langlands quotient theorem. Any age distinguished representation of hard B that exists sigma split Frobenius. And M intersect with H temp order. Representation tau log M, which is M intersect with H distinguished and mu G such that if you look at the mu inside SP star, it's in a positive form, this, and pi is the unique irreducible. Because the data is unique. And then, now finally, as example, group for the group case. So this recovers, well, this actually implies the usual. Unique up to the choice of positivity for the roots. And then our proof is basically, I'm running out of time, but let me just briefly mention that. There exists an analog of Castleman's criterion, or Cuevas' criterion. Castleman's criterion. H temp objects. But this was basically proven by Here I said basically, because for some reason they proved Castleman's criterion for H square integrability. Okay. But once you get square integrability, it's not too difficult to do it for Kempoff. So yeah. Essentially they are the theory developed by Kato Takano plays in. If I had 1 more hour, I'd program it, but I don't, so I won't. Okay, anyway, so that's all I have to say.
Questions, comments? Yes?
So why symmetric spaces and not spherical varieties?
No spherical varieties? Because spherical varieties are more general than symmetric. Basically, it's a lot of things have to be taken care of. First of all, the concept of sigma split parabolic is crucial for pretty much everything. But I don't know what that is, but I don't know what the analog is in a spherical variety. Right. Did I answer your question? Actually, that's a good question. P is equal to 2. So, essentially, what you need is to do something to prove this Castleman's criterion for a symmetric space. And I actually looked at the proof, and it's used at a very small place, only at a very small place. So the chances can be removed. But I haven't thought about it yet, due to my influence.
Anyway. This P is the residual characteristic or the
characteristic of the residual? Right, P is residual characteristic, not the characteristic. And if the characteristic is different from zero, probably P is 2, the characteristic is 2. I would say it's hopeless for the symmetric space of characteristics. It's probably hopeless, and if the characteristic is different from 2, but different from 0, maybe, but I haven't, you have to check so many things. It goes back to lots of things developed for symmetric spaces. So it's safer to assume that the characteristics are different.
Yes?
I was wondering how much more work would it be if you introduce a character? So instead of H distinguished, H comma chi distinguished, or some chi some character on H, and run through this program?
So I guess you're saying is that, so how, okay, for the main theorem, but, okay, indeed, I'm cheating a little bit here, because I didn't have time to talk about it. The point is, strictly speaking, not just H distinguished, suppose this guy is H distinguished with respect to lambda, that lambda has to be somehow related to, right, this guy, right, so the inducing data, and there's a way to relate. So basically, okay, I'm glad you asked the question. Basically, so, okay, let's, so pi, so we have this induced representation, tau, whatever. But usually it's Lagrange quotient, but you can actually do it with sub-representation by using like p bar. Okay, then now, from this, by Frobenius, you can just say Jacquet module with respect to p bar, and then this goes back into tau tensor UXP. And then Kato and Takano developed a theory which translates lambda for this to lambda for the Jacquet module. You know what I'm saying? So it's from maybe bar. Or maybe that's bar. So for each lambda for pi, there's a canonically corresponding lambda for the Jacquin model.
So let's take the speaker.